In this episode, we're going to get to work in building the single plane swing, my version of the single plane swing, from the ground up. Let's get started. Hey everybody, welcome back to Golf System, the channel where I use my game to try and help your game, and welcome to week number two of the in-depth single plane swing review. This series of videos is going to be my attempt to build a solid single plane swing that is very effective, very repeatable, and creates great results based on what I can find online, YouTube, reading around, and trying to figure it out for myself. Now, doing some research for this, there are three schools of thought to the single plane swing. There's Mo Norman's teachings himself, the way that he describes it in video and in writings and in various interviews over the years. Then there's Kirk Junga. He teaches a version of the single plane swing that kind of allows for some adaptability, maybe some flexibility, not so rigid in how he teaches it, but it is a version of the single plane swing. And then there's Todd Graves. Todd Graves teaches what he believes to be the gospel of Mo Norman. And what Todd Graves did, I think, that is really important is that he spent a lot of time with Mo Norman himself. And since Mo is a bit cryptic and can sometimes say some pretty confusing or weird sort of things, Todd Graves was able to almost interpret and translate, decode what Mo Norman said and what he believed and what he was showing in a lot of ways. And through biomechanics, he was able to take it and create sort of a system that we can all learn from for that. I don't know that I want to adhere to the Kirk Junga or the Todd Graves method. I think what I want to do for this review is to try and interpret Mo myself. Now, one thing about Mo Norman is a lot of the things that he said, they were based on his feels and they weren't necessarily reality. He would kind of contradict what he said before. So it can be really hard to decipher all of that. I'm going to try and find the common denominators amongst all three, Mo, Kirk, and Todd. I'm going to try and find the common denominators and make sure that I apply those. And then when it comes to any sort of nuances or differences between those teachings, kind of try a little bit of each one, and then I'll see which one makes the cut and which doesn't. All right, so today we're going to do a series of small swings with wedges, and I'll work my way up to sort of a three-quarter wedge, maybe even some full wedges. I don't want to get any more than that right now because you don't want to get too far too fast. It can lead to absolute disaster. I've done a lot of swing reviews. I've tried a lot of different things, and this is honestly the best way to make the transition is to start small with small shots and small clubs. My cousin Chris Christian wrote a book. Everything is professional, soft touch cover. It comes in hardcover, it comes in paperback. There is an ebook that you can download, and pretty soon there's gonna be an Audible version of it. Check this out in the back, the dust jacket. There's his picture. A lot of people say he looks just like me. He's not that lucky. But if you're into high fantasy, medieval, supernatural type of writing and you love books, please go give him some love. My Amazon link is always in all of my videos down below. It costs you nothing extra. Click the Amazon link, go to it, buy The Crimson Gods by Chris M. Christian. Show him some love from the GTD family. And if you enjoy the book, please leave him a review on it. He's put in a ton of work to write this book. It is not easy to do this, and I am so very proud of him, and I wanted to show him some love in my video today. That link will stay below in all of my videos. So first, let's talk about the grip. Where do you start? Mo said it was always in the palm. There are other teachers that talk about it being in the fingers. And from what I've seen online, it is sort of a combination. All of the teachers agree that arm and club unit is universally applicable. From this face on view, you want it to be just like you're pointing your left arm at something out in the distance. I also noticed that the back of my left hand should be in line with the leading edge of the club face. From this way, all right, you'll notice that my left arm and the shaft of the club, my arm is on a slightly different angle than that shaft. It's not perfectly lined up. In order to get it perfectly lined up, you would have to place this club in your palm. If you set it in the palm or the lifeline of your hand like that, and you got to try and take it back and cock your wrist, you can't cock your wrist correctly. It just doesn't work. It can't be running through the lifeline of that left hand. It has to be in a combination of palm and fingers, somewhere in between. But when you go to put your right hand on, now you want your right arm to align with the shaft on this angle. So you're gonna bring the right hand almost from underneath. If you hold your left arm out, my right hand is down below the shaft. So now I'm gonna bring it up. And that ends up giving me my grip, right? Now you'll notice my right arm is in line with the shaft from this angle. So when you put it all together and it's complete, you've got the left arm, which goes on, the right arm comes from underneath just like that. That is your grip. Now I have switched. I was always an overlapper. I've switched to a 10-finger grip because that's what Mo used. It doesn't matter who you're listening to, if it's Todd or if it's Kirk or it's Mo, there's one thing that is not negotiable. That is how the arms and the grip set up on the golf club. Now, where things start to get different is when you start talking about the lower body. Some instructors teach different things. Kirk Younga teaches a more flexible version of this swing, meaning that he allows for a little bit of customization. With Todd Graves, the lower body is pretty much pure Mo. It's the way Mo Norman did it. Kirk Younga's not telling you to get really wide, whereas Mo Norman and Todd Graves, they're all about having a much wider base. And I think that this leads to another variation in the teaching, whereas Todd and Mo, again, are saying that even after you finish, that right leg is going to stay back here and that right foot is going to stay on the ground until after the club pulls you out and up to your finish. Whereas Kirk Younga is teaching to take a more conventional stance or whatever's comfortable for you, to have that single plane swing, execute the swing, and allow your lower body to rotate, the foot to kind of come off of the ground and rotate toward the target. And the reason that he says to do that is because it allows for more distance and compression. You don't get those weak shots. But on these short shots like this, these pitches, we're not too worried about that at all. Another thing that's universal, it doesn't matter if you're talking about single plane or what you're talking about. If you're going to contact an iron or even a hybrid and it's going to be on the turf, it's not going to have a tee, that club grip is going to have to get to the ball before the club head, meaning that the shaft has to be leaning toward the target or the grip has to be outracing the club head, hands leading the club head through impact. The beautiful thing with the single plane swing is you're trying to preset everything anyway. You're trying to preset these angles that you're going to have an impact in your setup. So why not go ahead and do that now? Why not go ahead and set the club down and have the shaft slightly leaning toward the target, and then when I step in, I could take my left hand, make sure the back of my left hand matches up with the leading edge of that club face, and then my shoulder and my elbow and my hand are all in line with that shaft, and the hand is ahead of the golf ball at address, meaning that all I have to do from here is take it back and return it back down to that same position that I started from. That's what this system is supposed to be all about. That's what you're supposed to be doing, is really making this very elementary and saying, this is what I want it to be at impact, impact being king, so I'm going to set up for the impact position. Now, I played around a little bit with sort of allowing my right foot to come off the ground and then keeping my right foot planted. And I can tell you, it doesn't show up as much in the wedges. I'd really like to summarize what I found so far in the wedges, like in this session that I'm working on here, and what I found so far. There's something that I don't think can be overstated, something that I feel is going to be very important to me in moving forward, and it should be important to a lot of you who are going to try this. The entire reason for the single plane swing's existence and for why Mo Norman swung and set up the way he did was to eliminate variables, to create a better impact. This is something that all of these instructors, even when you're not talking about single plane, this is something that they all preach constantly. Mo Norman said it. Kirk Younga named his swing model after it, set up for impact. Todd Graves will tell you the same thing. And any other teacher that's teaching anything besides the single plane swing will tell you that impact is king. What that ball cares about is the moment of impact, how that club is interacting with that golf ball. What Mo Norman used to say is how you arrive at the ball, basically a foot and a half before the ball and a foot and a half after the ball. If you consider that 3-foot window, it's the reason that he built the swing the way he did. It's what makes everything work or not work. So, to that end, and keeping in the spirit of the single plane swing and trying to eliminate variables and just going about things in a very straightforward, elementary, kind of uncomplicated way, impact, the focus, the back of the left hand, for me, has been a huge help. If you focus on the back of that left hand, and then not so much, you know, what's going on over here or what's going on over here, But the way you're coming into the ball, once you get right here, you need that left hand to be getting square or pretty much square when you reach right here. When you reach this point, that needs to be pretty square to your target. And that hand needs to be leading that club shaft. When you get to impact, that needs to be dead square. And again, the hand needs to be leading the club shaft at impact. And when you get to here, you need to keep that club face square. And again, the hand needs to be leading the club shaft even after impact. If you're getting flippy like this, you've done something wrong at impact. You're here at impact instead of here. But if you can keep it and almost pulling that left hand square down the line, as square as possible, all the way out toward the target to where you're almost touching the flag stick with your left hand. Think about going down there and keeping it square to smack the back of the flag stick with the back of your left hand. To get set up correctly is one thing. That's half the battle. If you can get set up correctly, and you'll have to play around and decide if you want your legs wider or narrower together, but that arm club unit has to be, they all agree, the arm club unit has to be left arm aligned with the shaft, right arm aligned with the shaft this way. Maintain that and have that little bit of spine tilt, and that right hand can sort of act as a hammer. Almost if you were Sean Clement taking the hammer and driving it into the back of the ball, and then the left hand from here, that controls how square the club face is, and you want that squareness to go all the way down the line. One last thing to say in summary, and that is this. Anytime you're going to make a swing change, you're going to try a different swing method, you go to an instructor, you buy a book, whatever it is that you're talking about doing, and you're going to change things about your golf swing, or you're going to change the golf swing completely, there's always fine print. There's always a common phrase associated with that, and that phrase is this. It's going to get worse before it gets better. Well, I can tell you this much. With the single plane swing, there is another universal truth amongst a lot of the instructors out there and Mo Norman himself. Any of the books you're going to read, any of the videos you're going to watch, they make the promise that you can get better either instantly or extremely quickly. They say that it's not going to get worse before it gets better. It's going to get better before it gets great. And that promise, that sort of sales pitch alone, sounds almost too good to be true, but I can honestly say, just from the small experience I have out here, I haven't seen things get worse before they get better. I'm seeing it get better before it gets better. Guys, give me a thumbs up if you like the video. I appreciate you coming and watching this. Stay tuned for week 3 that'll be coming the week after this. I'll get into some more of the mid-irons and make some fuller swings. I'll try and show you some different angles down the line, and maybe we'll even get some more on-course work in the coming weeks. See you next time.